The world of photography is heavily dominated by males, but Annie Leibovitz broke through barriers to become one of the most influential photographers of all time. The U.S. Library of Congress declared Annie Leibovitz a living legend, and she is the first woman to have a feature exhibition at Washington's National Portrait Gallery. But her impact on culture can be better measured through her photographs that not only defined the identity of multiple iconic magazines, captured the spirit of a generation, but she continues to do so. Born in Connecticut in 1949, Leibovitz's childhood was like many of those in military families, constantly moving to whatever location her father was stationed. Samuel Leibovitz was a lieutenant colonel in the Air Force, so every few years, the family would pack their things in the station wagon and hit the road. Thanks to the diligent filming by Annie's mother, Marilyn, the camera became just another member of the household, a comforting presence there to capture the happy moments of a close-knit family. With all the time Annie spent peering at the world passing her by through the car window, this ready-made frame became subconsciously ingrained in her mind. There was the world inside the car, her reality, and the rest of the world at a comfortable distance through the lens that was the car window. As the Leibovitz children began to mature and the realities of the Vietnam War began to surface on the public's consciousness, the idyllic sheen of their nomadic lifestyle began to wear off. Her father was stationed in the Philippines while the family was marching to protest the war. Despite her descent, Annie joined the family at the Air Force Base, where she bought her first camera and began to experiment with photography.
When they wanted me to go to the University of the Philippines, I managed to talk them into letting me stay in San Francisco and go to school there.
Annie's sister was living in Berkeley at the time, so their parents felt safe about having her move to the Bay Area in 1967. She moved into a small apartment with several of her friends, and her room was the closet.
I went to the San Francisco Art Institute as a painting major. I had it all figured out. I was going to become an art teacher. But I learned very early on that you can't become an art teacher till you become an artist, you know, and it was this... I said, really? The following summer, I took a workshop in photography. They asked you to go out that morning, take pictures, develop them in the darkroom that day, and that night you were sitting and looking at what you did and talking about it. You go out and walk around, and the immediacy of it, there was like a shared community wash where your prints came out, and you wanted to make sure that if your print was out there with everyone else's, it was okay and it was good. It was something really just wonderful about the whole process. It clicked. It clicked with me. Sorry. The School of Photography at the San Francisco Art Institute was really based on Robert Frank, who was considered the father of 35mm photography in the United States, and Cartier-Bresson, who represented the same kind of photographer in Europe. They were considered the first photographers who took photography in a way it had never been done before. They made it portable, very, very portable, very, very relaxed, very, very fluid, because they had a small camera. And this is how I learned to take pictures. It was personalized reportage work. The very first book that I began to realize what it meant to be a photographer was a Cartier-Bresson book. And it was called The World of Cartier-Bresson. I remember sitting down, looking at that book, and seeing that you could travel the world. You know, the camera gave you this license to walk out and be alone in the world, but you know, you were there with a purpose. It was a very important discovery.
When you were in school, what attracted you to photography?
Well, I think the painting program at the Art Institute was you know, painters, it was very abstract, and it was very isolating. You know, painting was very, you know, the painters felt very isolated, I think, from the rest of the school. You know, I had gone to the Philippines to visit my parents. My father was stationed at Clark Air Force Base, and I ended up going to Japan that summer and buying a camera and climbing Mount Fuji and, you know, buying a Seiko watch, and went back to school and took a night class in photography. And I'd have to say some of the initial feelings about photography were really the seduction of the darkroom, you know, just being... I loved being in the darkroom and watching, you know, the images come up and in the chemistry. I mean, it was very, very magical. Also, that you could see something and have it, you know, in a few hours, you know, see it in another form, you know, almost immediately. In other words, you would have an idea or you have a point of view, and then you get to see it sort of materialize. And, you know, I think the immediacy of it, I was really captivated by. I mean, the fact that, you know, you could have something so fast. And painting was a very slow process. You know, I was very impatient.
San Francisco not only welcomed Annie Leibovitz to the area in 1967, but that very same year, a new magazine was born in this epicenter of music and culture. Rolling Stone magazine was founded by a then 20-year-old magazine editor named Jan Wenner, and his mentor, the jazz critic of the San Francisco Chronicle and co-founder of the Monterey Jazz Festival, the legendary Ralph Gleason. In 1970, Annie showed up at Rolling Stone with a bag of pictures, and from that moment forward, Annie Leibovitz and Rolling Stone magazine became intrinsically connected.
Annie was, you know, one of the closest editorial collaborations I've ever had with anybody. And she, you know, defined the look, you know, helped define the look and the style of Rolling Stone. And, you know, even though she hasn't worked steadily for us for 10 years now, somehow her spirit is still in it in a very serious way. I mean, I suppose half the public currently thinks that she still works for us. But that collaboration was really intense and very, very productive.
I was looking to be adopted and and found, found Jan and Jane. You know, it turned into family for me. It was more than, a magazine, it was a way of life. The first cover was actually one of the photographs from the peace rally. And it was a crowd shot, and they used it as an illustration for revolution in the country, you know, at that time.
It started as photojournalism. She'd go on the road with rock and roll groups or, you know, go to places, you know, we'd be covering a lot of cultural stuff at those times, of say, you know, religious, Maharishi type, you know, extravaganza, and she'd do that. You know, the campaign trail, the 1972 campaign, whatever we were doing, she was in the thick of it. I mean, she was working every day of the year.
You know, those early years were really golden in the sense that there was a lot of strength in being able to photograph without people thinking that you were doing anything. It was sort of like being invisible. You know, I'm thinking back on Lennon, and Lennon was always like trying to put me at ease and trying to, you know, let me relax. I think I always looked so worried. There was a certain kind of, let's help her out. Let's just help her get through this.
At Rolling Stone, Leibovitz had the freedom to cover the stories that interested her, rather than being given each assignment like with most magazines. Her role was to photograph the world that her generation was living in, and her photo essays often decided what the next issue of the magazine was going to be about.
And there were a lot of times that the pictures were the crutch for the magazine. You know, they didn't have a story and they just ran the pictures. That was, of course, true with Hunter filing for Nixon leaving the White House.
Mistakes, yes. But for personal gain, never.
When Leibovitz went to cover Nixon's farewell from the White House, she did not have the same access as the White House press corps, but that turned into an opportunity to present a different viewpoint than what the New York Times and the Washington Post would be showing.
I had to wait till the crowd had left, and then I took my picture of some sort of detail. And to see those details sort of blown up large in the magazine, they were very powerful.
Unlike the curated frame chosen by the Nixon White House for the media to capture, Leibovitz stayed on as the other photographers left and showed the candid moments as the spectacle was dismantled. Rolling Stone writer Hunter Thompson had been working on the Watergate story leading up to Nixon's resignation, but when the moment finally came, he was unable to finish the piece. The magazine instead ran Annie's photos of the day, a testament to how powerful and emotive the images were.
in order to do the best possible kind of photograph of what it is that I'm in right now, I really have to be in it. It has to be around me. That is the best kind of photography, is what is around me. You know, like, you become part of it.
What Annie would do was she'd spend 2 or 3 days on the road with the person, 2 or 3 days in their life. It was Fleetwood Mac or the Allman Brothers, she'd be on the bus with the Allman Brothers for 3 or 4 days and achieve a level of understanding and depth. That's what makes these photographs that she did so intimate and so revealing.
In order to get the best possible pictures, one had to become part of what was going on. You know, just do everything that was going on. And then you're there and no one pays you any mind, and you can take the pictures you want to take.
At that time, we were all doing lots of oddball cultural things, poor houses in Nevada, you know, any kind of subculture, slice of life thing, and certainly this was a window into that culture we didn't know much about.
I met Annie the first time on a flight down to South Africa in 1975. When I went down to compete in a Mr. Olympia competition. Annie is a person that is very good in adapting to the circumstances and to the people that are around. So she was very quick in adapting to the bodybuilding world. She knew how to talk to the bodybuilders and she knew how to make you feel good. She always has a way of kind of sneaking in and becoming part of your life. All of a sudden, you didn't even notice that she was taking pictures and recording the whole thing. No matter where it was, there was Annie, but you didn't really say, get her out of here, she's in my way. You always felt like she's one of the gang.
Being a fly on the wall gave an almost voyeuristic quality to her photographs for Rolling Stone in the 1970s. And in 1975, another Rolling Stone by the name of Mick Jagger invited Leibovitz into his world.
When Mick Jagger asked me to be the tour photographer, I jumped at it. You know, I remember Jan Winter said to me that he couldn't guarantee that I would have a job when I came back to Rolling Stone if I did this. And he was not very happy about me going off to do it.
She actually came on the whole tour, which is like a very long time to want to photograph.
Leibovitz had by this time been working for the magazine for 5 years, photographing the biggest stars in the music industry. But going on tour with a rock band opened her eyes to what it really meant to be a Rolling Stone.
I was so lucky, and I've tried to say this many, many times, I was interested in photography, you know, and not rock and roll or music. I was interested in always trying to get a great photograph. I just thought, well, God, the tour, that's great. We're going to all these different cities. We're going to be staying at the best hotels in every town. They're going to have a tennis pro there. So I'm going to take some lessons, and that's what I'll do. And of course, you know, 2 days into the tour, I never saw the daylight again. I mean, I was up all night. It's a romantic story. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, being young, being on the road with the Rolling Stones, you know, doing everything and, you know, holding on tight to my camera.
She was so bored after a while of photographing Rolling Stones. You know, there's only so much you can do. And I think that's what drove her to feminism. But anyway, she said, I keep looking at you guys' c**ks all the time. I just keep looking at your But when she'd finished doing that, she used to photograph the audience. And I think there's some good pictures of that period when she does all these audience snaps, which in some ways are just as interesting, but more so than the band.
I became very interested in the audience. I would spend a lot of time wandering through the audience, looking at the audience. You know. I would watch people sort of give themselves up. I didn't see that photograph as adulation. I actually saw it as desperation. People sort of smashed against a chain link fence. It was very poetic. You know, but it looked very painful to me.
It's very difficult to photograph music. It's something in the air. But you can photograph the energy and, you know, what it takes. You know, I don't think anyone realizes the kind of strain one is on when they're on stage. I like to call it my Francis Bacon, you know, because it has a very gory quality to it.
In a certain way, you know, I was trying to show that life on the road was not glamorous, you know, that the idea of propelling one's body through space a lot faster than it's meant to go took its toll. And their lifestyle, you know, it was a very hard lifestyle. And you know, I was trying to show, to try to de-romanticize it, you know, to show a side that was not so pretty.
Going on tour with the greatest rock band was too seductive an opportunity to turn down. The consequences, however, of being one of the boys was something felt in the morning when the booze and the drugs started to wear off. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll was part of the package, and unlike her previous assignments where she would pop in and out, Leibovitz was entrenched for the whole tour.
It wasn't very work-orientated, and there was a lot of sort of hanging out and taking drugs and so on. Sort of more so perhaps than the 60s, or just different drugs from the 60s. So it was that era. And yeah, I think that Annie did a lot of pictures that remember that or reflect that, when you look at them. I think she was very aware of all that. Oh, she was very much part of it. She was a sort of hands-on. She wasn't like so much as a fly on the wall as kind of one of the guys, you know, taking part in everything. She liked to be one of the guys.
You know, I basically gave myself up to whatever was going on and felt that was what one did as a journalist or as a you know, in that kind of reportage work. That in order to get the best work, you had to sort of totally be involved. And people talk about the soul of the sitter, but there's also the soul of the photographer. And you know, I basically almost lost, you know, my soul. I mean, it wasn't the Rolling Stones' fault, you know, it was my fault for allowing myself, you know, to give myself up, you know, to go in something so deeply that, you know, I let it, you know, overtake me.
She's very, very hardworking. She's fantastically perfectionist, I think. She would get so furious if something went slightly wrong. But she would really push the subject to the point of torture, I think, almost.
Jan Wenner advised Annie against going for the whole tour, knowing the destructive consequences of that environment. But by the end of the tour, Annie left with a lifelong friendship with the Rolling Stones, a reputation as the number one photographer in the world of rock music, and a drug addiction. After the success of her Rolling Stones tour, Leibovitz found her fame a hindrance to the documentary style of photography she was used to. Her subjects were too aware of her presence, and it was a struggle getting the same authenticity. This period also brought a big change to Rolling Stone magazine, when they moved their headquarters from San Francisco to New York City.
I happen to think that the cover idea that we've evolved now, you know, which is shooting against the wall, white, seamless, is fantastic, and we're gonna. I intend that to continue with this style for the indefinite future on everything, and make this a style of Rolling Stone covers. I love it. It looks beautiful.
That's why they have to always shoot on white, because as long as it's a consistent style, I think it will do the same thing.
New York City was the epicenter of publishing, where the best written and photojournalism was coming from. But the growing pains of the cross-country move was felt by the entire team at Rolling Stone.
We moved from San Francisco together to New York, and I think that was a very difficult move. It was very hard. I mean, it was the beginning of the end of Rolling Stone as I knew it, and it felt much more commercial, you know, moving into New York, and we all had to grow up. You know, we felt like we were staying forever young, you know, working out of San Francisco and doing the work that we did. And, you know, what we did, I think what Rolling Stone instilled in me, and I was so lucky, imagine being a young person working in a place what they instilled.
You're in your 20s.
In my 20s. You know, they instilled at a very young age that what I did matter and was important.
Rolling Stone magazine offered the young photographer unbelievable opportunities, but being so new to the publishing world itself, it couldn't provide Annie with the guidance she needed at that stage of her career. Thankfully, the move to New York introduced her to a new artistic crowd, including the art director Bea Feitler. Bea had worked with Richard Avedon at Harper's Bazaar in the 1960s, joined the iconic feminist journalist Gloria Steinem to launch Miss magazine in 1972. But at Rolling Stone magazine, her impact was most greatly felt by Annie Leibovitz. Bea took Annie under her wing and pushed her to look at her work more objectively, taught her the importance of editing, and the necessity to approach each sitting with a preparedness that she was unaccustomed to.
I would look at my contact sheets for 5 hours, trying to figure out which one, you know. And she could look at the contact sheets and in 3 minutes she would have it edited. She knew what was the best one. I didn't say, how she do that? I have a good example of when I did something wrong. It was a group cover with Bruce Springsteen and James Taylor and Bonnie Raitt and Jackson Brown and Carly Simon. I think it was an anti-nuke rally. Jan wanted to put them all together. And I went and took the pictures and just kind of threw everyone against the wall and took their picture and came back with the film, you know, to Bea. And she looked at me and she was just so angry. She said, you know, you really messed up. I mean, here was this, you had this opportunity and, you know, it was, you could have made something of this. You could have made it a very important photograph. You could have done something that would have taken this thing to another level and you wasted that opportunity. It was a very, very important lesson. That one has to, you know, just take it to another place, and you can make it something that means something to other people.
She started investigating what other photographers had done over the years and concept stuff and bringing in props, and she just brought this wonderful thing to it, which was that a concept somehow was going to be deeply connected to something about this person. I link that to her picture of Bette on the Bed of Roses.
We were doing promotion for the rock and roll movie called The Rose. I saw that there were a lot of roses, and I thought, oh my God, I'm going to be scratched to death.
I mean, these are just flower market roses, and they came in all thorned. And there was a last minute hysteria because I couldn't have her lie down in thorns. And we were sitting there with like clippers trying to dethorn these roses, you know, before she came in.
And I looked and there were so many thousands of roses down on the ground. And I thought, oh, she removed every one. Oh my God, she's so thoughtful. And then I was her slave.
I get a letter a week after things comes out from Avedon saying, you know, dear Jan, Annie's cover of Bette is the best solution for a magazine cover I've seen in 30 years.
I think that Bette Midler was a very important picture because it was the beginning of trying to think of how to do a setup photograph.
She kept doing that. I mean, Fleetwood Mac on that mattress shot from it, brilliant. And they all had been having affairs with each other. So here, without saying that, here they all were in the same bed and twisted around, and this one with that one, sheets. I mean, it was genius. I think of that Blues Brothers cover. The idea when I first heard it, oh, paint their faces blue, I thought, oh, we can do better than this. You know, that's so, you know, obvious and dumb. But done, one's done. It's stupendous.
They were very reluctant, and they felt, you know, they had basically were front men to, they had hired some of the greatest, you know, musicians to back them. And they felt that it might offend them if they put on blue paint. And they had like the best, they had hired some of the best musicians. And so they were very reluctant. And Dan said, I'll do it, whatever you want. And Belushi said, you know, okay. You know, I really basically got a roll off. And then Belushi sort of stormed off. I had a roll or two off. And then he stormed off. And he didn't talk to me for about 6 months. And then it calmed down and we worked again.
It got to be that I would walk into a room, and after three or four or five years working for Rolling Stone, and my subject, who would be supposed to be really in my frame, is suddenly walking up to me, and my frame is, you know, getting in, and saying, "Oh, hi, Annie. How are you? What's going on?" Blah, blah, blah. And the dynamics changed. I could no longer be
you know, just sort of invisible. I mean, suddenly your subject was sort of, not only was he sitting there talking to you, you know, and not being involved in his life so that you could just photograph whatever was going on, you know, he was suddenly saying, what do you want me to do? You know, and that sort of, I don't know, what are you doing? Or, you know, I mean, it's, and, you know, I think that I became more comfortable with something that sort of said, this was posed and this is set up.
Well, I love the Steve Martin picture. I see a portrait of Steve Martin not being like a face shot or something, but Steve Martin is more of a concept than, you know, than let's say a portrait and then a head shot. So we sat down in his living room in LA, and he was looking around his living room, and he had just acquired a Franz Klein painting, and which of course no one, you have to, I mean, I've only seen them in museums. They cost like $1 million or something. Not quite a million, it's an exaggeration, but so he said, well, I'd like to be in that painting, you know. So I looked at the painting, and first I saw Steve as a big black, you know, dot, you know, in the painting. But I said, okay, you know, and we hired a Disney scenic painter to come in and paint him. And then we did it right in his living room. And I love that it has, it's set up, but it also has a lot of elements of realism involved in it. You know, it is Steve, it is his living room, it is his painting, you know, and it's his idea, which I think it really shows him.
With each story, Leibovitz grew more confident in her execution, but there is one such cover whose impact was stronger than she could have ever realized.
This is the CBS Evening News with Walter Cronkite.
Good evening. The death of a man who sang and played the guitar overshadows the news from Poland, Iran, and Washington tonight. Former Beatle John Lennon, who was 40, was shot and killed last night outside his luxury apartment in New York. The alleged killer is an unemployed security guard and printer who had lived in Hawaii. News of Lennon's death touched off a wave of shock and mourning around the world. Steve Young reports.
You know, we have a picture here that is so famous of John Lennon and Yoko Ono, and you took this just hours before his death. What happened here at this shoot?
Well, this was actually done for the cover of Rolling Stone magazine, and I wanted to photograph them, both of them nude, embracing, and this is not unusual for John and Yoko. They've been photographed in, they had press conferences from their beds,
right,
you know,
I remember.
For their, you know, their career, and at the last minute, Yoko decided that she didn't want to, you know, that she would take her shirt off and not her pants. So I said, well, go ahead, leave your clothes on. And of course, you know, I was disappointed, but it turned out to be, you know, a much stronger image. The idea of the embrace, you know, at that time, the fact that they were still in love, you know, and they loved each other deeply was important to me, and I wanted to try to tell a story about that.
Why didn't you release this to the media right after he died? You waited, didn't you?
Well, I obviously, I mean, was just stunned by the fact that, you know, he was killed that evening, and I felt very strongly that it would be as if I was exploiting his death. You know, I really didn't want to, sell the picture. I would have done differently if it had happened now, because in a certain way it was a strong photograph, and it would have been nice if it was seen around the world. You know, you have to think about other things besides the money. I mean, it was a strong photograph. It would have been nice as a last photograph of John. I mean, people now know it's the last photograph of John, but
right.
At the time,
it was such a horrible, shocking time for all of us to go through the death.
It was the end of an, you know, it was definitely the
end of an era.
When we shot the first Polaroid and I peeled it and he looked at it, he was very, very excited. You know, he said, you know, this is our relationship.
Once John died, I mean, there's no question that we were going to use it, and then went further and decided it just didn't need any headlines at all. So it was the one issue of Rolling Stone ever that we put out that had no type on the cover except the logo.
John, you know, he didn't know the idea till I got there in the morning. And he got right into it. He said, no problem, you know. And that was John. You know, he was willing to go to extremes, you know, to express his point. And so
he was killed that night. He saw the Polaroids. He loved the Polaroids. He thought it really expressed his relationship with Yoko. And I promised, he was really afraid that the Rolling Stone wasn't going to run on the cover because he felt the Rolling Stone really just wanted to run him on the cover. He wasn't going to run Yoko. And I promised him it would be on the cover. So when he was killed that night, I pulled myself together the next morning and went into Rolling Stone. And they were already mocking up a cover for just his face, you know, on the cover. And I said, away, you know, this is John Lennon, this is the way it's going to be. So we ran the shot of him naked. I thought it was also very brave of Rolling Stone to do that, you know.
After nearly 13 years at Rolling Stone, Leibovitz became synonymous with the magazine. Her identity became indistinguishable from that of Rolling Stone. A new opportunity arose when Vanity Fair asked her to come work for their magazine in addition to Rolling Stone, thanks to the help of Bea Feitler. By this time, Annie's drug use was getting out of hand, and her increasingly reckless behavior was impacting her work. She was leaving rental cars around the country, missing deadlines for photo assignments, and the culture of Rolling Stone wasn't helping her. It came as a surprise to Leibovitz, but Jan Wenner rejected the idea of her working for both magazines, knowing that Annie needed to get clean and that doing so would be impossible if she remained in the world of Rolling Stone.
Those times were a little crazy. I mean, that was the peak of the drug times, and pretty much everybody we were covering and everybody we were working with was taking drugs, you know, in one form or another. And, you know, it just got, you know, kind of crazier and crazier, and Annie got into it perhaps a little heavier than most. And after a while, sort of just kind of took over and started managing her and her managing the drugs. And it led to some pretty rough times.
There is this myth that you have to be in a lot of pain, you know, to be working. And I think I certainly fell into that category of thinking that it did make it, in a certain way, you know, easier to work because you really didn't have to have a life, you know. It took care of any other needs, you know, that you had.
You know, finally came to a place that was just best for us to kind of part ways at the end and get her out of a milieu that might have encouraged her to take drugs and also get our operations back on a more even keel and, you know, and get off that roller coaster that Annie had become.
You know, I got professional help and it was done. And I just took a deep, deep, deep breath and moved on.
Leibovitz came out of rehab and transitioned from the world of rock and roll and into a new sphere of celebrity. The readers that grew up with Rolling Stone now had money and power, and Vanity Fair was the magazine on the rise for them.
I was so lucky to work with Annie Leibovitz. And when I first arrived at Vanity Fair, you know, when it was all such a big mess, a classic glass cliff situation I came into, I had to go in over the weekend and redesign the magazine. And spent 4 days with the art department just hurling things out in and out and like making the new design that we had to do fast before the next issue. And I started to ransack the art department for photographs. I knew there were drawers full of treasures. I just sensed that there must be these photographs that this very profligate magazine had just been assigning, that there's bound to be some great stuff. And lo, what did I find when I opened the drawer in the art department was an unpublished, fantastic portfolio that Annie Leibovitz had done of comedians in every shape and form. I mean, there was Whoopi Goldberg in the famous Bath of Milk, which became an iconic picture. And there was Pee Wee Herman hanging upside down from a lamp. And there was all of these hilarious pictures of these comedians in different situations. And so I put them all into the magazine, gave it 10 pages, and I called it, was the April issue, so we called it April Fools. And it was absolutely glorious. And that was the sort of beginning of my collaboration with Annie, who was thrilled to have been sort of brought out of obscurity she was very famous at Rolling Stone, then hired by Vanity Fair and had kind of not been used. So this was the beginning of our great collaboration. And we did so many great portfolios, covers, you know. She became the iconic visual definer, really, of Vanity Fair's whole look and feel.
This was for a series for Vanity Fair magazine on young upcoming comedians. All I had for research was a very badly done video of her nightclub routine. In that, she plays a little girl who is trying to use Clorox to thinking that if she washes her skin that underneath it will be white. And it was a very poignant part of her show.
And then she said, even if you sit in the vat of Clorox till hell freeze over, you ain't gonna be nothing but black. And she was right, cause I sat in the Clorox and I got burned. And she said, I just had to be happy with what I got, but look, see? It don't do nothing. It don't blow in the wind. And it don't cascade down my back. It don't, and I put that bouncing and behaving stuff in it, and it didn't even listen. And I want some other kind here to do something else. I do.
You know, I met her at her house in Berkeley, at her apartment, and we went to, her friend had a better bathtub, and I was thinking that she should just be in the bathtub scrubbing, as if she's scrubbing off her black skin. A friend of mine who was an advertising photographer said that milk photographs really nicely white. So we had gallons and gallons of milk in pots on the stove, and we heated them up because I couldn't put her into cold milk. And we poured the milk in, and then she got into the milk bath, and she kind of slipped down into it like that. And I went, oh my goodness, this is graphically amazing.
We used to have great brainstorm sessions together where we would just kick it around. And I would think, wow, you know, light bulb.
Even my work is criticized sometimes for being too on the surface. And I sometimes find the surface interesting. To say that the mark of a good portrait is whether you get them or you get the soul or whatever, I just don't think this is possible all the time or some of the time. And could I get the soul? I guess I probably could if, you know, you gave me a year or so with each person. I would get the soul, I promise you. I just don't think it's necessary, except with the people who love you and you love them and maybe you want to go that step further.
Annie's work at Vanity Fair was attention-grabbing, flashy, and exciting. But her cover of actress Demi Moore in her eighth month of pregnancy caused a reaction none of the team saw coming.
When we got there that day, the one thing that I had said to Lori Goldstein, who was the stylist, is that I felt very sexy and that I wanted to portray that in the photographs. That I said, I think you should go and get beautiful lingerie, black lingerie, and I want to depict how I really am feeling and how sexy I think the pregnant body is and a woman in that time. And so it wasn't as if we came up with some big, you know, revelatory idea. It was just like the most natural thing for us to do. And I wasn't even really thinking of it as a cover of that. And then as we were in the position, I looked up and I said, Annie, wouldn't it be great if they used this for the cover? And then we all kind of looked at each other and said, there's no way. There's no way they're gonna do it.
The backlash to the Vanity Fair cover was swift and coming from every direction. On one side were those shocked that Demi Moore would dare to expose so much of her body while pregnant, instead of hiding herself away for 9 months and emerging with child. On the other side, some feminist magazines were angry at the photos for apparently setting an unrealistic standard of beauty for a woman during her pregnancy.
This one caused quite a stir. Did you expect it to?
Absolutely not. It was the most, I knew it would be sensational and glamorous. And I knew it would be a different cover, but I had no idea that it would cause controversy that it did cause. And I think that says something about how people perceive women, you know, and men, or people period perceive women in this country. I mean, you can see women in bathing suits and practically nothing on. No one thinks anything of it. And then to see a woman in the most natural of all states, and for there to be that sort of controversy, I just thought, you know, that it was ridiculous. It was the most natural thing for us to do. I was Demi and Bruce's wedding photographer. I photographed Demi when she was pregnant with her first baby. We did some photographs together, and while we were shooting this, Demi said, wouldn't this be great if this was the cover? It was actually her idea. And it was Tina Brown for Vanity Fair who had to make the decision, and she went with it. She said, this is great.
I think that the taboo is that women can't exude that they've had sex in any way to have gotten in this shape. I mean, you know, you think of even how women are, you know, supposed to dress when they're pregnant, and it's very covered, very hidden.
I couldn't take it too seriously to begin with, and I realized that I
you know, that it was too important of a photograph to a lot of women. I had to understand it a little better myself, you know. I didn't know what I'd done.
The publisher of Vanity Fair decided to put the magazine in a brown paper wrapper, obstructing the controversial image. This worried editor Tina Brown, but she underestimated America's obsession with the forbidden fruit, a decision which drove sales even higher.
It's a photograph that's copied over and over and over and over again, and that, you know, it makes me so happy to see, you know, to see it, you know, emulated and copied and done. And I mean, really, before then, you know, if you were pregnant, you were supposed to go sort of hide in a corner and be heavily clothed, and you know, and this was sort of a coming out in that respect.
The explosive sales from the cover with Demi Moore brought a new problem for the magazine. How do you follow up on such a success? Tina Brown's solution? Putting Demi Moore on the cover again, showing how great she looked after giving birth.
I look like a leftover suit.
A single image can have a profound effect. I have as many people come up and respond about those covers as much as I have for films I've done.
As driven as she was to maintain her success as a photographer, it was the influence of Susan Sontag that pushed Annie to care about her work in a different way. Sontag and Leibovitz met in 1988 when Susan had a sitting for promotional photos for her upcoming book. Sontag was one of the most acclaimed literary figures of that time and whose essays on photography happened to be of her most famous. The unlikely pair began a relationship, Annie the artist, Susan the intellectual.
You know, and I kind of thought about this relationship with Susan. I thought, oh God, this is going to mean I'm going to have to be good. This is going to be about my work. That's what it's going to be. To know Susan.
Because she wouldn't have it any other way?
That's right. She was tough. She really
she
wanted.
She set a bar.
She definitely set a bar. She didn't have to do much to set a bar. I mean, she was the bar. You know, she was an extraordinary woman, and if we miss her right now, it's because we miss someone who could talk about this time.
She could define the time.
I don't hear anyone like that.
Sontag was also responsible for renewing Annie's exploration of dance and doing projects that fed her artistic appetite. Annie's mother was a dancer who took lessons from the famed modern dancer and choreographer Martha Graham, the first dancer to perform at the White House. Photographer Barbara Morgan captured the work of Martha Graham, studying the dancer's choreography and selecting moments to feature. Annie pored over these images, and they informed her approach to photographing movement. In 1991, Annie went to Florida to photograph famed dancers Mark Morris and Mikhail Baryshnikov for the White Oak Project. Morris had a bit of a reputation as one of the bad boys of dance, known for his musicality and often called the heir to George Balanchine. Baryshnikov is widely regarded as one of the best ballet dancers in history, and together, the pair created original works for the White Oak Dance Project that toured for over a decade. During the dance rehearsals, Annie sat back and captured the dancers as they developed the choreography, the photos ranging from explosions of intense dynamism to the moments in between, exhausted bodies collapsed on one another.
I think it's probably one of the more important photographs I took of them because in Baryshnikov you see the ballet and Mark, you see the modern dance. And
the hands are so remarkable. They're very subtly different, but really say a lot about the two men.
Yes.
The series evoked her early work for Rolling Stone magazine, or even the tour images with the Rolling Stones. During her time at the White Oak Project, Leibovitz came to the conclusion that dance could never really be photographed, and how wonderful it actually was that dance was an art form that lived in the air. Even if the best she could ever achieve was a portrait of dance, her work was still a love letter to these incredible artists. This was her first time photographing Mikhail Baryshnikov, but Annie would continue to work with him throughout their careers. In 1993, Susan Sontag asked Annie to join her in Sarajevo to photograph the ongoing destruction in a splintering former Yugoslavia. Sarajevo had at this point already been under attack for over a year, the people trying to go about their daily lives, not knowing if a sniper would cut their time short. In her book At Work, Annie describes being driven through the western edge of Sarajevo when a mortar came down in front of their car, ripping through the back of a teenage boy on a bicycle. They tried to rush him to the hospital, but he died on the way. The realities of war and the randomness of the destruction leveled Leibovitz and put her work into perspective.
Because I remember I had to go from being in Sarajevo to right back to doing, you know, Barbara Streisand and stuff like that. And suddenly, Barbara Streisand didn't seem so relevant. What side Barbara Streisand needed to be photographed from didn't seem, important.
Although her time in Bosnia shifted her own worldview, Leibovitz had to wrestle with the concept of celebrity upon her return. Her own celebrity status brought attention to her work in Sarajevo, to eyes more focused on the glitz and glamour of Hollywood. Annie's photographs of the famous in turn made her famous, and in the United States, there are few things more valuable.
Almost every celebrated figure of our times knows an unassuming young woman with a camera named Annie Leibovitz. From the Stones to the Trumps, photographer Annie Leibovitz has captured everyone who's anyone.
I think that it's a society that's totally lost its bearings in terms of what its values are, and so it's putting all its value into celebrity. There's such a lack of spiritual self-confidence, perhaps, that the achievers seem to have to be the kind of the sort of the holy cows that people worship. You're always in a confrontational situation with publicists in regard to stars. The great thing about Annie is that Annie is her own person. And if I can get Annie accepted by the stars agent, then I know I'm going to get a great shot, because Annie won't put up with any nonsense. Her interest is in getting a memorable shot, and it isn't necessarily the shot that the star would pick.
Stand there. Let's go right there.
Are you the biggest photographer in the world?
Yeah.
Is it
like rankings?
Vanity Fair magazine, under the editorial eye of Tina Brown, loved to push the envelope, often to the chagrin of her advertisers, like with the story of comedian Roseanne Barr. Unlike the sterile, meticulous images of celebrities that their publicists and the readers expected, the photos with Roseanne and her new boyfriend Tom Arnold were wild, messy, and dangerous. Annie found herself at the center of another controversy when she photographed Queen Elizabeth II in 2007.
And the BBC has had to apologize to the Queen for wrongly implying that she stormed out of a royal photo shoot. It's also apologized to the photographer Annie Leibovitz. A trailer released for a BBC documentary series on the Queen appeared to show her walking out of the photo shoot after a disagreement with the photographer. Well, the story's been repeated in most newspapers this morning, but this lunchtime the BBC has had to admit that it wasn't really what happened, and that the actual sequence of events was misrepresented. The Queen hadn't walked out at all.
This morning's headlines and news bulletins were full of it. The Queen, it was said, had stormed out of a photo shoot the day the Queen snapped. How did they know? Well, this image is from a new trail for a BBC documentary that was shown yesterday to journalists. In it, they had seen her posing for the photographer Annie Leibovitz and being asked to remove her tiara.
Could we try without the crown? Just, it will look better, less dressy, because the garter robe is so extraordinary.
Less dressy? What do you think?
It was then followed by shots of her appearing to walk out, sounding decidedly unhappy.
I've done enough dressing like this, thank you very much.
Well, it appears the editing misrepresented what really happened. She hadn't stormed out, and today the BBC apologised.
You know, the truth is, I mean, I'm so used to people, you know, not liking to have having their picture taken. I think it's a very difficult, you know, it can be a very difficult process for some people. It's very psychological. And, you know, I mean, I don't want to exactly equate it to like going to the dentist, but, you know, it can be a daunting, you know, experience. I mean, not, of course, you know, for a queen, but, and she probably, it was interesting to do my research, you know, on her not only is she probably the most well-known person in the world, but she's also the most photographed person in the world. I mean, it was just overwhelmed with the amount of work there was to see of her over the years. But the truth is, I mean, she's in her 80s, and you know, she the cape she was wearing is like 75 pounds, and I think I was told I was interrupting one of her favorite television shows for the day, but you know, and she walked in, and you know, she was a bit, you know, cranky to begin with, and a bit feisty, but you know, right after it was over, I turned to her press secretary and I said, God, I just love her, she's great, because she was irritated, and you know, but she was walking into the shoot, and then she just sort of got to work, and she didn't leave until
she's,
you know,
a pro.
She's
actually, if you watch this,
great,
she's a pro.
Resolve, great sense of duty, all those things. She didn't leave until I said we were done. I mean, she never walked out, and that's why she was incensed about what came out and what was said, because she would never. She said in her 50 years, she's never walked out on a photo.
Although she did a little testy when you asked her if she could remove her crown.
Well, you know, that, and she had every right, you know, and I thought she was being funny. And I know when she says, what do you think this is? You know, because I said, you know, what happened was this kind of shoot where you have 20, 25 minutes, they're very well planned out. She, especially at her age, she's not going to make a change, you know, in clothing. So, you know, everything is sort of planned. She was supposed to come in without it on, and then we were supposed to add it. And so she came in with it on, and I said, you know, isn't it a little bit, you know, dressy? I mean, and what I really meant was that I wanted to try this very regal, formal, clothing that she had on, without the crown, because I thought we didn't really need to have the crown, because there was so much else, you know, and you could see her. I thought you could see her a little better without the crown. Of course, she was upset, and she says, "Well, dressy, what do you think this is?" You know, and I thought she was being funny.
So,
but, then again, she went ahead and she did take it. She did take the crown off, and she also put it back on.
I just liked her feistiness. I was really impressed with it. And at first, I wasn't too sure if she was kidding or not. And then I realized she wasn't kidding, and I thought, oh, this is going to be a 5-minute session. I thought she totally pulled herself back together and started to enjoy herself. And she totally wanted to make sure that she did her part on her end.
Annie and the Queen would meet again in 2016 for the May issue of Vanity Fair, celebrating the monarch's 90th birthday.
It was incredible this time to go back and photograph her, because she had her ideas of what she wanted to do. She wanted to be photographed with her dogs, she wanted to be photographed with her daughter, and she wanted to be photographed with her grandchildren. And she didn't mention anything about her son or her husband, but... But this was her list, and this is what we did.
A big part of growing up professionally for Annie Leibovitz was evolving past the idea of her work as a purely artistic endeavor, but rather a highly sought-after commodity that gave her power and agency in the world.
I read in the early days you really were uncomfortable accepting money for photographs. Why?
Well, I felt I couldn't do what I wanted to do. I felt that if I was going to be... paid for something, that it was suddenly became I had to do something for the person I was photographing. I think one of the very first things Sissy Spacek asked me to do her album cover. She did a country western album, and I was just a wreck during the shooting, because I ended up saying, please keep the money. I mean, it was difficult. I felt I had to please her, and it's a really important
that you please yourself.
So artistically, you felt encumbered then.
That's right.
Now, though, a day's work earned you a lot of money. Mm-hmm. Is it different now? Is it different always once you're established?
Well, I had to find the right kind of work that made sense for me and for my work. The American Express work and the Gap work were really extraordinary campaigns, and they really asked me to do my work, and they made it quite explicit. They said, we don't want to interfere, we want you to do exactly what you do. And I grew with that, and I learned to use it and to put it back into my editorial work.
In her work with American Express, they allowed Leibovitz the freedom to push the conventions of advertising by creating bold campaigns that stood out in the pages of the magazines. Each featured subject brought an entirely new concept and energy to the photos, expressing their individualism and style. As the work with Amex continued over the years, the campaigns became less high art and more similar to glamorized snapshots in the life of the subject. This type of creative relationship was also mirrored in her work with Gap, a rapidly growing jeans brand from San Francisco that was hiring the biggest photographers in the industry to shoot their campaigns, like Richard Avedon, Steven Meisel, and Herb Ritts. Her portraits for Gap included a range of characters, from movie stars like Winona Ryder to literary legends like Joan Didion. In 2006, Gap launched the Do the Red Thing campaign shot by Leibovitz, a revolution in how nonprofits raise money. Harnessing the power of celebrities like Red co-founder Bono, the proposition was simple. Can a t-shirt change the world? This one can. 50% of the profits from Red items went to the Global Fund to finance programs that help women and children affected by HIV/AIDS in Africa. The next year, Leibovitz shot the Classics Redefined campaign. In 2010, Let's Gap Together paired people with the same profession from different sides of the globe.
This campaign is very, very important, and we realize that we represent our countries, and we realize that it's bigger than both of us.
I think it's a very interesting campaign. I mean, East, West, I mean, you know, the world gets smaller by the day, and at some point, the more communication, the more we are connected to one another, the more positive that is.
I love the symbolism of what this shoot means, because as we go into the 21st century and a new young generation, this represents putting the challenges behind us in the past and history and moving forward together in a way that we can build a world that is safe and that is free.
Outside of the fact that Gap is a brand that we both are very familiar with and support, you know, it is our collaborative efforts that make us stronger in music, that make us stronger philanthropically, that makes us stronger as people. So when we do fill in those gaps in life, magic happens.
The idea in this campaign was to simplify the look, you know, very, very much, and just, you know, see two people together from two different cultures. We realized the very first day we photographed, when we were bringing American culture together with Chinese culture, it was very, very powerful. Everyone understood that it was something bigger than just photographing clothes. On the other hand, I think what's always been extraordinary about Gap and the clothes is that it's very democratic, Gap clothes. It's you know, everyone can wear it.
He saw that Gap is a very strong culture. 咁將呢個gap搬去中國大陸，即係證明個文化本身大家可以溝通嘅。咁gap可能會影響咗國內好多唔同嘅人對衣服嘅睇法，因為gap唔係一個好明貴或者好咩，佢好casual，中學生着、小學生着、翻工嘅着，即係呢個就係生活。 即係從呢個生活裏面，我就慢慢覺得就係今日我哋兩個都我講廣東話，佢講英文。 但我想很快呢，就他讲 国语、我讲英文。
我觉得Gap 他当然，我觉得让很多可能看似有不同的东西，其实创造出来那种艺术是还蛮特别的。所以希望这一次的广告出来可以让大家看到很特别的冲突性，但是有一种和谐。
Getting a chance to work with Annie is one of the great experiences, great honors of my life.
跟她在一块工作，我觉得非常就是自然，特别随便，就是觉得就是把自己的东西发挥出来。
曾经想过，我说如果能和她一起工作，应该是一个很兴奋的事情。对，没想到就 Gap 就那个促成了这件事情。
When I was a child going to school, I couldn't afford clothes to go to school, and when the Gap came along, they created clothes that became hip and cool.And everyone could wear them, and they didn't cost that much money, and it was powerful. The look of what is fashionable doesn't have to be expensive. So I've always admired the Gap, you know, for that. But that being said, you know, it was a brilliant idea from Gap China to pull these two worlds together.
I think Gap 选到这些人，然后把这个事情做了，就证明我觉得 Gap 挺牛逼，跟别人不一样的。
Gap 能够喺未来嘅发展喺大陆里边咧，亦都系将。世界的文化走在一起，亦都是我觉得是时代的转变，这个是转变的一刻的。
Most people think of Annie's work for American Express and Gap, but Leibovitz had another client that shook the ad world by creating one of the most acclaimed national campaigns in history. That client was Milk. In 1993, Michael Bay, who we now associate with pyrotechnics in the Transformer movies, directed a commercial for the California Milk Processor Board.
$10,000 question, it's a tough one.Who shot Alexander Hamilton in that famous duel? All right, let's go to the phones and see who's out there.
Hello?
Hello, for $10,000, who shot...
Alan Blair.
Excuse me?
Alan Blair. Hold on, let me get some milk. No!
I'm afraid your time is almost up.
Alan Blair!
I'm sorry, maybe next time.
Got Milk.
Got Milk was licensed to the National Milk Processor Education Program in 1995, where Annie Leibovitz was brought to capture celebrities from different worlds. Supermodels, athletes, TV, and film stars. The dairy industry started seeing a decline in sales starting in the 1970s, with companies like Coca-Cola and Pepsi aggressively marketing themselves as fun to consume.Milk Does a Body Good of the 1980s was ineffective in convincing customers to choose the healthier option. By the 1990s, it was sports drinks and companies like Snapple selling themselves as healthy alternatives to soda, so milk had to strike back. Market research on children at the time showed that they viewed milk as a boring staple, so the Milk Mustache campaign was designed to make milk more interesting and to emphasize its wholesomeness. When Leibovitz was approached to shoot the Got Milk campaigns for print advertising, she saw the power of being in such a ubiquitous campaign.At a time where print magazines were thriving. The client was only paying $25,000 per ad, a paltry sum comparing to what these celebrities were used to getting paid, but the opportunity to be photographed by Leibovitz was something most people jumped at. All of the subjects had to be milk drinkers, so Whoopi Goldberg wasn't featured until 1999, when they ran an ad for lactose-free milk.
I can't help but believe that these vehicles that I'm working within, that there's such wonderful ways to get work done, that I believe I'm doing good work within a commercial landscape, and that the opportunities are too interesting and the work is too extraordinary. But it's the tension of that. Am I being too slick? Am I doing this? Am I doing that? Or is this, you know, good? Is what creates the work.
Annie's milk mustachioed portraits can be viewed as a nearly two-decade ledger of who was top of mind in popular culture. Although fashion photography was never Annie's main interest, her work with celebrities attracted Anna Wintour at American Vogue, who who was pulling the magazine away from models on the covers to actresses on promotional tours and other famed figures in popular culture. One of the most memorable of these shoots was a story on current fashion designers leading the industry, with one of Vogue's favorite models, Natalia Vodianova, playing Alice in Wonderland with designers like Marc Jacobs and Tom Ford as the other characters in the fairy tale. Being able to use Annie Leibovitz was a huge benefit for Vogue, since stars would jump at the chance to work with her. Anna Wintour appreciated this pull and would accommodate Annie's wishes for the opulent productions.
If you ring up Nicole Kidman and say, you know, Joe Smith's going to photograph you, you know, next month, you know, a big yawn. If you ring up and say Annie Leibovitz wants to photograph you for the cover, you know, she'll be there that night, you know, with bells on. She puts such a stamp on a picture. I mean, you can look at her work and there's no way anyone else ever took that picture. There are a lot of photographers out there. They don't really suffer and agonize and obsess the way that Annie does. She cares. She cares.
As a prelude to the 2012 London Summer Olympics, American Vogue commissioned Leibovitz to highlight some of the stars from Team America. With the help of model Carly Kloss and gowns from designers like Oscar de la Renta and Alexander McQueen, Leibovitz masterfully balances the power of these superhumans with the elegance of a supermodel. The result was not only one of Annie's most memorable works at Vogue, but a great tribute to the hard work of these Olympic contenders. At least for a few weeks every 4 years, athletes from less recognized sports like gymnastics and swimming were elevated to rock star status. The cover featured soccer player Hope Solo, swimmer Ryan Lochte, and tennis legend Serena Williams, who Annie first photographed for Vogue with her sister Serena in 1998. A few months later, all three of them went on to win gold medals in London, with Lochte actually winning 2 gold, 2 silver, and a bronze. In a 2021 interview with Financial Review, Leibovitz describes her relationship with fashion, admitting that in the start of her career, she didn't take fashion seriously at all and that to her, fashion seemed like the low end of the spectrum. One of the things about fashion is that models know what they're doing and they like being photographed, she says. That was such a new thing for me. I felt like the dentist before that, you know? Everyone hated me. To enter this world where people liked being photographed and would play along, I couldn't believe it. It felt like I was cheating or something. As resistant as she may have been initially, the fashion industry embraced Annie, with the biggest clients in the luxury market hiring her for their campaigns. Since many clients were moving away from models and towards actors for their major campaigns, her reputation as the go-to photographer to the stars made her the perfect fit. From Prada to Christian Dior to Louis Vuitton, everyone wanted to work with Leibovitz. With the support of the industry behind her, Annie saw an opportunity to push the boundaries of her photography, taking the documentary style of her previous work to elaborate productions in hard-to-reach locations and giant, expensive props. This was the new look for Leibovitz. This new direction found a perfect partnership with the global juggernaut that is Disney. 2007 marked the launch of the Disney Dream Portrait series, casting the animated classics with superstar celebrities. Disney had dipped their toes into the live-action reboots with the 1996 release of 101 Dalmatians, but this series with Annie can be viewed as priming the audience for what would become a huge part of Disney's future strategy. we see many familiar faces from Annie's previous work, like Mikhail Baryshnikov as Peter Pan and Whoopi Goldberg as the genie from Aladdin. Disney continued the series over the next 7 years. Leibovitz photographed another Disney princess for Vanity Fair in 2008, Hannah Montana star Miley Cyrus. The backlash and media circus that ensued was completely unexpected by those involved, but one can never underestimate the American pastime of finding perversion in the slightest sliver of skin. Mommy bloggers like Lynn Burris immediately called for a boycott of Miley Cyrus and encouraged parents to burn all Hannah Montana merchandise. In the week after the photos were released, Miley issued an apology in People magazine, saying, "My goal in my music and in my acting is always to make people happy. For Vanity Fair, I was so honored and thrilled to work with Annie. I took part in a photo shoot that was supposed to be artistic, and now, seeing the photographs and reading the story, I feel so embarrassed." Disney went even further by issuing a statement saying, "Unfortunately, as the article suggests, a situation was created to deliberately manipulate a 15-year-old in order to sell magazines."
I really do separate myself in some way, you know, when I go to work. But, you know, the Miley picture was a beautiful, strong, simple picture. I mean, we took all kinds of pictures that day, and it turned out to be one of the strongest pictures. I think it's actually sort of innocent. On some level, but I feel like that, she loved the pictures and she loved taking that picture, and she was ready to take that picture, and it's just, you know, her audience, you know, wasn't ready for that picture, and the thing that it was just different. The picture, you know, it was really different of her. I've said this now in another place, but basically I think that if there was any mistake made, it's probably that she shouldn't have posed for Vanity Fair. You know, that's my recent take on it. But, you know, I think she got very nervous after they had the reaction. And she sort of, you know, she backtracked in a lot of ways, and I felt bad for her. I really felt bad for her. I think she really did enjoy the shoot. I still, you know, totally believe in the picture and think it was fine. You know, it was like taken out of context.
A decade later, Miley finally shared her true feelings about the photos.
Miley, I'm very curious about, this is something that you tweeted yesterday, and so this is a screen grab from Twitter. You wrote, "I'm not sorry, F you, #10 years ago. So you took a picture of this New York Post. Did you have this in your house? You came across
No,
it?
No, I found this because I never really keep track of the years that have gone by since something like this. And mm-hmm. So I guess it was apparently 10 years ago. And I think a lot of things have changed. And I think the conversation has changed a lot. And I think, something that I really thought about was, you know, sure, some people thought that I did something wrong in their eyes, but I think it was really wrong of someone to put on top of someone that this is my shame and that I should be ashamed of myself.
Well, that's the New York Post.
That's not a nice thing to tell someone that they should be ashamed of themselves.
No, yeah, but that's...
Besides Donald Trump.
But did you...
And
at that time, did you apologize
for doing that? I don't remember.
I think I did, but I'm sure someone told me
someone
to.
Told
but you.
You
know what? That's why I don't do what people tell me to anymore, because that idea sucked. So they want to know why I come on, you know, TV shows with no shirt on. Blame them.
Do you remember who told you to apologize? Do you have any recollection of that?
I think at that time, I just wanted this to go away. And I think I also was trying to balance and understand what being a role model is. And to me, I think being a role model has been my free-spiritedness and sometimes my unapologetic attitude for decisions that I feel comfortable with. And in the day, it's like anything else. For me, when this photo was taken, and I know this will probably get turned around too, but when this photo was taken, my little sister was here on set. She actually was sitting with Annie Leibovitz taking photos too, and there was nothing sexualized about this on set, and it was everyone else's poisonous thoughts and minds that end up turning this into something that it wasn't meant to be. So actually, I shouldn't be ashamed. They should be.
Do you think about... You go back and think about now that you become hugely successful, you can do pretty much anything you want. Do you still dwell on those things that you wish you'd either done differently or the people who wronged you? Do you go back and think
about that? I try to not even think about yesterday because it's such a waste of time. And today and tomorrow are way more exciting because I can do something today. And actually tomorrow I wouldn't worry too much about either.
Okay. Yeah. But this was in your head.
Yeah, or on my feed. It popped up on my little Instagram feed, and I thought, hey, telling them to go f*** themselves sounds fun right now. I was bored.
More recently, Disney reconnected with Leibovitz to do promotion for their Star Wars films in Vanity Fair. Disney executives have spoken about how important it is for them to drum up anticipation and create monumentous events for the release of the Star Wars movies. Using Annie for these promotional images was part of that strategy. There are few photographers who've been able to shoot a magazine cover with such a cultural impact as Annie Leibovitz, first with her Rolling Stone cover of John Lennon, and then the Vanity Fair cover with Demi Moore. Once again, Annie Leibovitz found herself at the epicenter of the cultural zeitgeist with the Vanity Fair cover of Caitlyn Jenner, her first public images since coming out as a transgender woman.
I knew it wasn't going to be journalism, but I wanted to base it on, I wanted the foundation of journalism there. So we basically did it all in her house. And the idea was we would try on all the clothes and go through it. It really was a two-day session of emergence. I mean, she really did emerge, you know, over the 2 days. These are sort of chronological. That was one idea with the corset. I originally wanted to be more conservative with her, and was looking at photographs of Katharine Hepburn, and I realized as I was doing research that whatever look she had was going to be an acquired look. You know, this was an acquired idea of what is a woman, and you know, you had this, of course, expansive idea of, you know, what is a woman? You know, I mean, you know, what should a woman look like? I mean, like, how does a woman dress up? I mean, who is Caitlyn? And, you know, can we stay on this a minute? Because this probably is my journalistic shot, you know, and I don't think I ever told you this, Graydon, but it was an important shot to me because towards the end of the second day when I sort of felt like I was being dragged behind a car because she just took over. I mean, she is an Olympic athlete after all. But the first day she was very quiet, and then as she started to sort of gain her confidence, and I do think that as much as we knew we were doing these photographs for a magazine and a cover, we were really, when you're in it, you are doing the photographs to make whatever she was hoping to be. You wanted that to be a success for her. And that is why I'm not really a journalist, is because I have empathy and I have, you know, have to make those decisions as we're doing it. But I think our whole team, and it was a team of people, really wanted it to be successful for her. And we wanted to take her over, you know, over the hill. Now, I do think she has a long road still to go. But I think what she's done so far is pretty amazing. And but this picture, I like it because there was a moment in the second day when I think Kim Kardashian came over and she was trying to get her children to come over to see her. She was so excited. And she went back into the dressing room and came out, and I think the hair and makeup might have started drinking at that point. And she came out a little bit more, you know, you know, than I thought was a good idea. So, and that was this moment, and I didn't think I was ever going to run this. And then I just felt, you know, it's the one where you can really see her arms and you can see, you know, who she really is.
As print magazine sales slip, the demand for behind-the-scenes content increases. Vanity Fair was quick to recognize the shift and would use the BTS content as an opportunity not only to allow viewers to connect with the celebrities in a different way, increasing the likelihood they would want to pick up the actual magazine, but it also gave a glimpse into the way that Leibovitz works. Unlike other photographers who try to hide their process as if it is precious intellectual property, like the notoriously private Steven Meisel, Leibovitz is happy not only to share, but also to educate. In 2017, she partnered with the online platform Masterclass for 15 lessons over 3 hours that cover topics like the photographers who influenced her work or how to bring images to life in post-production. For those looking for a step-by-step tutorial on how to execute one of her pictures, this program is not for you. Most of the lessons are more akin to interviews, but that should not come as a surprise given Annie's point of view as a photographer.
I'm so not a technical photographer. And what camera are you using? I think because I embrace the idea that I'm interested in content and not so much interested in the technical side of photography. You know, I when digital came along, you know, it was too obvious that this is what was going to be. It was beautiful. I took Polaroids. You know, I loved it, but it was time to move on. And I just didn't want to waste time not getting started. Do you think the digital, that there's more play in the photograph itself, you know?
Right.
It's in another place, and I actually really like it.
Is that how you, I noticed in some pictures that the one that you did of Kanye and Kim, and it's from a mirror, like you can see that the mirror, but you weren't there. Like, did you just Photoshop yourself out?
I did.
Okay. She's just not there.
That's good. But you know what? We are really smart. We know something's been worked on or played with. It's not like we're not pulling wool over anyone's eyes. And that's the thing about the whole digital work. I mean, I can't stand when it's blatant, you know, but it's like it is a whole other kind of genre coming out with the digital work now that it's a little bizarre. It's definitely a whole new world.
I feel more like a creative artist using photography, because there's the digital work is so interesting now.
So the first word for you is artist, not photographer.
Thank you. Yes, I would like that.
You're an artist who uses a camera. That's your brush. That's your pen.
It's come to that. I have had many different stages of photography, as there are many different ways to take photographs. But I feel now I'm in that stage of my life where I use the camera, you know, in that way.
When you're out with your kids, do you take a camera or do you shoot on your iPhone?
I shoot on my phone now.
You told me a while ago, this was maybe 3 years ago, that almost anything you do with the big equipment you use, you could do with an iPhone at this stage. Or a cell phone.
Almost. I mean, I was really impressed when I was on the Star Wars set to see J.J. Abrams walk around with his iPhone and use it as a, for how to frame. And I was so impressed with that I immediately went back and we just went to Cuba and photographed Rihanna, and I wish I had done more of it on the iPhone. I actually literally one of the backgrounds in the blue bedroom is an iPhone.
That's interesting. Yeah. And when you're shooting a crowd scene, a big camera is better than an iPhone. You know, when Rihanna, there was all those pieces.
I haven't tested the iPhone enough. I just got the new one, and I want to immerse myself more in it. But I do think it's you know, the only difference between, well, there's lots of, I mean, if you want to take a photography seriously, you want to be a serious photographer, it's certainly more work. But when I first started taking pictures, to have a camera, that was the difference, whether or not you had the camera with you or not. So the fact that you can carry that iPhone with you and have it with you, and it has such ease, it's just incredible. It's wonderful.
But it's the way you compose them. You have doubles sit in for the people, don't you? And to get the lighting right, so much of what you do is about incredible lighting.
We do, yes, I do sit people down, and I do try to figure it out as best as possible. Because when the subjects come in, I really try very hard to spend as little time, just try to do as fast as possible. Because I think the attention span in a photograph is like about 10 or 15 minutes. I mean, it can be longer than that, but I don't believe that it should take that long. I think you should be able,
That's because you've done your homework ahead of time. You've
try to.
Posed it.
You really try.
Especially when her subject is a world leader, time is limited. Her recent shoot for Vogue with Ukrainian president and first lady has split public opinion, some claiming it is romanticizing war and others applauding the story for bringing attention to the suffering of the Ukrainian people. Much of the criticism focused on the fact that the images were published in a woman's fashion magazine rather than in a news journal, but both Leibovitz and former actor turned leader of Ukraine understand the power of reaching as many people as possible. More than half a century has passed since Annie stepped into the office of Rolling Stone magazine, but her career is showing no signs of slowing down. She smashed through the glass ceiling, went toe-to-toe with presidents and pop stars, producing covers that are touchstones of culture. Her work may be controversial, but it is undeniable that the photographs of Annie Leibovitz changed what it means to take a successful portrait.